2016 Christian Spirituality Lectures. I'm Dr. Eric Magnuson. I serve as an assistant professor of theology here at Spring Arbor University, and I also direct our master's program in spiritual formation and leadership. The Christian Spirituality Lecture Series is an event sponsored by the MSFL in conjunction with the Andrews Chair in Spiritual Formation here at the university. Each year we bring in scholars and practitioners to invite us into deeper experiences, reflection, and conversations on topics that either directly or tangentially relate to Christian spirituality. This afternoon, it's my distinct pleasure to introduce our speaker for this fall's event, Dr. Lauren Winter. Dr. Winter has served for over a decade as a professor of Christian spirituality at the Divinity School at Duke University in North Carolina. She writes and lectures widely on Christian practice and the history of Christian spirituality and practice, especially here in the Americas. And she also serves as the vicar of St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Lewisburg, North Carolina. I first encountered Lauren's work back in 2002-ish when I was a seminarian and picked up her book, Girl Meets God. I was looking for narratives of hope from other young spiritual seekers who were striving to weave together the life of the mind with a rich life of God in the world. I was instantly struck by her book. I continued to follow her work from a distance along the way. Her two lectures today will flow out of her most recently published volume, Where in God, which explores the importance of our language for God and how it both opens up and closes off different ways that we can relate to God in our lives. We're honored to have Dr. Winter with us today. I hope that you're both intellectually stimulated and spiritually blessed. Not to create a false dichotomy between those two, by the thoughts that she shares with us today on wearing and eating God. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Winter.
Thank you. I'm glad to see so many of you here this afternoon. This lecture now on a lecture at 7:30, and they really are just one lecture that I'm going to sort of break in half. In an hour, we will wrap up our time together now, but I might be in mid-sentence if we do that. I'm not sure where I'll be. I'm glad to see so many of you, and I hope to see you again at 7:30. I want to begin by telling you a little bit about my own spiritual journey and how I came to be interested in the topic that we'll be exploring over this two-part lecture, the topic of the Bible's many metaphors and images for God. So I'm going to take the first few minutes of this hour to just give you a little bit of my own Christian journey to give some context for the more meaty biblical explorations to follow. So I didn't grow up Christian or in the church. I grew up Jewish, and as an adolescent was deeply, deeply, deeply into a life of Jewish observance. I attended a very wonderful synagogue in Charlottesville, Virginia, and still and all today, when I think about my most profound experiences of spiritual formation, the formation that I received in that community at the synagogue in Charlottesville remains really foundational for me. And I was really, I was sort of a synagogue nerd. Like my youth group today at my Episcopal church, the teenagers who were always hanging around the church, I call them their church nerds. So I was sort of a synagogue nerd, and I spent as much time as possible at that synagogue, and I was allowed to begin preaching there when I was 14. I preached my first sermon on the rape of Dina. The text of that sermon, thankfully, has been lost to the mist of time. I have no recollection of what I said, and I'm sort of glad that I can't recall what I said. So I was deeply engaged in a life of Jewish faith and Jewish practice. And I went to college in New York City, and I chose to go to the school I attended, Columbia University. I chose to go there for reasons that I'm guessing are similar to the reasons that many of you have come to be a part of this fine university, and that is the life of vibrant faith and vibrant intellectual reflection on the faith that was available at Columbia. Columbia had a really large student group of students engaged in a life of Jewish practice. So I went on to Columbia. The women at my synagogue threw me a kind of farewell ritual when I left for college. They gave me a set of Shabbat candlesticks and some Kiddush cups. And I think everyone assumed that eventually, like a decade later, I would come back a conservative rabbi. I think that was everyone's reasonable fantasy of what I would be doing and how I'd be living my life in 10 years. It was really no one's fantasy that I would come back an Episcopalian. So I do not have one of those Christian testimonies that involves becoming a Christian at a dateable moment. I cannot tell you that I became a Christian at 10:04 in the morning on January 2nd, 2006. That's, of course, a venerable way that Christians have given shape to our spiritual experiences. The Apostle Paul had a dateable conversion like that. There are probably some folks in the room who had a dateable conversion. I sometimes envy you. I didn't have one. I instead had an experience during college, so for multiple years, just having my attention drawn to Jesus and having my desires sort of oriented increasingly toward Jesus. And I'll just tell you two little anecdotes of how my attention turned to Jesus when I was in college. The first, and it has taken me, I need to be behind this podium, it has taken me a couple of years, well, many years, to be able to tell this story with a straight face. When I was a sophomore in college, do we have any sophomores here? Show of hands. Okay, sophomores, watch out what is happening in your spiritual life. When I was a sophomore in college, I had a dream. And in the dream, my friend Michelle and some other women friends of ours, we were all kidnapped by mermaids. See, it's hard to tell with a straight face. We were kidnapped by mermaids. We were taken down under the ocean to Merland. And although we didn't like grow tails or sprout fins or gills, we could somehow function just fine underwater, unexplained in the dream how that happened. So it turns out that mer society is quite advanced and full of interesting things to do. And the mermaids were pretty nice kidnappers. They didn't keep us locked away in darkened rooms, etc., tied up. We could do whatever we wanted down in mer society. We just couldn't come back to terra firma. We couldn't come back to land. So I was in the dream down with the mermaids for about a year when a group of men came on a rescue mission. Now, just as an aside, it has always troubled me that the gender dynamics of this dream are female victims and male rescuers. But we can discuss that later if you want. So this group of men came to rescue us, and frankly, most of the men were sort of paunchy, middle-aged NFL watching type of men. But one of the men looked exactly like Daniel Day-Lewis. Now, remember that I'm talking about a dream that I had, alarmingly, about 20 years ago. So do not picture the Daniel Day-Lewis of the Abraham Lincoln biopic, but try to cast back your memory or imagination. For those of you who weren't alive, you can imagine, and for the rest of you, cast back your memories with like the young, hunky Daniel Day-Lewis. So I was convinced in the dream, I was sure that he had come to rescue me, and that he would sort of participate in the group rescue effort, but I was the reason that he had come. So we were rescued, we went back to land, and then I woke up. All right. Now, I have kind of weird dreams pretty much every night, and I usually remember them. So it wasn't weird for me to be dreaming about magical creatures like mermaids. What was unique about this dream in my life was that I woke up, sophomore in college, observant Jew, totally sure that the dream had come from God and that the dream was not actually about Daniel Day-Lewis, but that that rescuing figure in the dream was Jesus. So, I don't know how much you know about Judaism. You probably know that there's not a whole lot of room in the observant Jewish life for thinking that God is sending you dreams about Jesus rescuing you. Like that, at that point, you cease to sort of be in a normative Jewish framework, right? So there was not a whole lot of room in my life for this belief that God had sent me this dream about Jesus rescuing me. And therefore, I thought about it with some anxiety for a few weeks, maybe even months, and then I just sort of shelved it. I just put it in a box and didn't think that. The second thing I'll tell you about my collegiate spiritual experience is that the summer before my senior year of college, I stumbled over these novels called the Mitford novels. These are middle brow, there are actually nine of these novels. These are middle brow Christian fiction. They don't have plots. They just follow the main character whose name is Father Tim, and he is like the world's perfect pastor. He is an Episcopal priest, and he's the perfect one. He even has the perfect basket of pastor foibles, because a perfect pastor can't actually be perfect. They have to have some correct foibles. He has them. In these novels, you just follow him as he like ministers to his people in a small town in Western North Carolina. He falls in love with his next door neighbor, who's a children's writer with great legs, and they get married, and they take in a bunch of foster children. Oh, and they have a dog who is controlled not by the normal canine commands, but is controlled by the recitation of Bible verses. The point being, like, we should all be controlled also by the recitation of Bible verses. So I read the first two of these novels the summer before my senior college. I just stumbled on them in a bookstore. And I was completely, I just fell in love with them. It seemed to me that the characters in these novels led lives that were saturated at every point by intimacy with God and by faith. And I read them and I wanted to have a life like that. So eventually I graduated from college, I moved to England, I was baptized, I joined a church. I don't have a day to give you. I could tell you the day I was baptized. You said, Lauren, you must give us a day that you became a Christian. I would give you my baptismal date. But so over these few years, I was drawn into attention to and intimacy with the God of Israel through Jesus Christ. So I was about the most enthusiastic new Christian you could ever hope to meet or possibly not meet. You know the phrase, the convert's zeal? I was that person. I was just totally into it. And I had this intense sense all the time of intimacy with God and intimacy with Jesus. And I was like 20, and I thought that this is just how it would be for the rest of my life. I thought I've had not a dateable, but nonetheless a fairly dramatic conversion. It was a conversion that had some real costs. My Jewish family members were be hurt and upset about this conversion, and I caused some pain to a lot of people in my Jewish community. And it was wrenching in its way, this conversion. So I thought, I've been through this wrenching experience, but now I have this palpable intimacy with God, and I am going to feel this forever. I'm just going to have more and more of this for like the next 85 years, and then I will die and go to heaven and have more of it here too. So, turns out that's not what happened. And if I can, those of you who are younger than I am, which is most of you, if I can give you just like one little hint about Christian spiritual life, it would be this hint. Rarely do things in the Christian spiritual life just stay the same forever. Would you agree with that, Eric? Okay, so Eric and I are both telling you that rarely in the Christian spiritual life do things just stay the same forever. And sometimes that's really deeply annoying, and sometimes it's fabulously interesting, and sometimes it's terrifying, and sometimes it's a relief, and sometimes it's all of those things combined. But the one constant is that there aren't very many constants in the Christian spiritual life. So I had this intense intimacy for some years, and then it began to fade. And I looked up one day and suddenly realized I hadn't actually like felt the nearness of God for months and months. And I didn't have any idea how to get that feeling back. And I didn't really quite know exactly why it had vanished. And in the church, we often say that when people have this experience, this like, where did the intimacy with God go? We sometimes say they're having a spiritual dry spell. I personally think that's a pretty dismissive way to describe it. Sometimes we say they're having a dark night of the soul, which is a phrase that we borrow from the Catholic Reformation mystic, St. John of the Cross. What we almost always say is it's fine for you to have this kind of sense of not having any intimacy with God as long as it only lasts about 6 weeks. And if it lasts longer than 6 weeks, you must be doing something wrong. Like you're not praying hard enough, or you're not listening to your community enough, or you're not having enough quiet time or something. Let's get it wrapped up, 6 or 7 weeks. So my experience of this sense of feeling quite far removed from God lasted multiple years. And part of what was so harrowing about it, well, first of all, I just missed God. And second, no one had told me to expect this. No one had said, this actually happens to a lot of Christians, and it's actually a normal part of the Christian life. It's okay if it doesn't happen, but it's okay if it does happen. And just hadn't known to expect it. So it was several years of confusion, really doubting my faith, doubting God, and just really not, other than knowing that I should keep going to church, I really just didn't know what to do about this. So I was in that season for some years, and here too, I don't have a dateable moment. There was not a dateable moment at which it got fixed. But there was then a season where I began to notice that God wasn't actually absent. God was maybe just present in different ways than I knew how to discern. And I began to realize that in the Christian spiritual life, the goal is almost never to get back to some experience you had 5 years ago. That the better goal is to say, how can I notice what God is doing in my life now? And if God seems to be absent, where is there somewhere I haven't looked yet? Or what am I learning about God's mystery and God's freedom through this feeling of God's absence? And if God is absent, is it God who has withdrawn, or have I withdrawn from God or from my real self? So I began to be able to pay attention in different ways to where God was, and I began to feel again a deep sense of intimacy with God, but it was a changed intimacy. It was not the intimacy I felt when I was like 19 and a new Christian and totally on fire for everything all the time. It was a much quieter, and yet oddly it was in some ways a more palpable intimacy. So during that time of this recovered, renewed intimacy were the seeds of my subsequent kind of scholarly investigation of biblical language about who God is. And I began to get curious, my academic self, my intellectual self, began to get curious about this. I don't know why I just said that. I don't actually think that I have an academic intellectual self and then a spiritual self, then like a culinary self. I do actually think the call of the gospel is a call of integration. I'm not sure why I would put it that way. Strike that. My integrated self began to realize, as I was entering into this kind of new way of being intimate with God, I began to realize that I had pretty limited language for conceiving of who God was, is, and will be. And that basically when it came down to it, I thought of God as some combination of a wise college professor and my boyfriend. These were like the main things I thought about and the main channels in which I thought about the triune Lord who created creation and has and is redeeming it and sustains us all. wise college professor and boyfriend. Now, these are not terrible ways of thinking about God. These are not terrible baskets of figurative language or images for God. In fact, they're pretty darn biblical. There is actually a lot of language in the scriptures for having, you know, God as bridegroom, erotic language, romantic language between the believer and God, between Israel and God, between the church and God. So it's actually deeply biblical to think of God as your boyfriend or girlfriend or whatever. And, you know, wise college professor is not bad either. There's a lot of biblical language about God as our teacher and Jesus as a teacher. So these are fine ways to think about God as far as they go. The problem is they just weren't going to go all that far by themselves. And I began to realize that in some ways they were just old. Like, they were old metaphors for me. And they were not old. Sometimes things are really great because they're old. You know, sometimes things take on a lot of meaning because they're old. So if you have your grandmother's champagne flutes and you, every time you use them, here we are on a dry campus, every time you put sparkling apple juice in them and toast, then you remember that your grandmother always used them at Thanksgiving, and you remember your sister toasting her beloved at her wedding with these same sparkling apple cider flutes, and the flutes are meaningful in large part because they're old. So sometimes things are meaningful because they're old. My metaphors for God were not old in that way. They were old like, they were like a 1964 health sciences textbook. So a 1964 health sciences textbook might be interesting for what it has to tell you about health pedagogy in the 1960s, right? But it doesn't actually do that much for the present moment. So I decided that I needed to investigate some new imagery for God. And just checking the time here. And at the same moment that I was realizing that I might need to expand my vocabulary, my imagery for who God is, I was also getting deeply into the Bible for the first time. Now, I do want to pause and note that there's a certain oddity here. I had spent, have spent my entire life in religious communities, Jewish communities, and then Christian communities that are deeply into the scriptures and that encourage the community to read the scriptures corporately and encourage individual reading and study of the scriptures. And I've been my whole life in such communities, and I just hadn't really gotten on board with that part of being a person who is in relationship with the God of Israel. I tried to read the Bible on and off, but I will just tell you with some slight embarrassment, I found it boring. I found it boring. I also found it confusing. Like, I'm pretty used to being good at things, and I'm certainly used to knowing what's going on when I open a book. And I would open the Bible and just actually not, I was just lost. I would just get confused, bogged down in Leviticus or Second Chronicles, confused, bored. So I had had like efforts to read the Bible, but I had just never really gotten into it. Super happy to read theology, the mystics, church history, but not a huge Bible reader was I until at this moment that I was having this, whatever it was, phase three of my spiritual life, this renewed intimacy with the Lord, I fairly suddenly got super into the scriptures. And I will say a little bit more about some scriptural reading practices that I encountered that I will commend to you. But for the moment, it really was like Cupid came down and like shot me with the scripture arrow. I mean, I just became fairly quickly, deeply into and infatuated with the scriptures. And for the first time, I understood what my like Baptist friends meant when they talked about the Bible being the place of God's most abundant presence to us. And when they would talk about how they were most awake to the Lord when they were in the Word, like for the first time ever, I got it. And I got just kind of pretty geeked out for starting to read the Bible. It was probably kind of cute and annoying for those in my life. So you can see how these two questions would converge, right? You can see how a person who is on the one hand saying, I might need to like go further than God as boyfriend and college professor, and that person is also newly geeked out on the scriptures, that such a person might ask herself, I wonder if the Bible has anything to say about this. I wonder if the Bible can help seed my imagination past college professor and boyfriend for how to give some language to who I know the Lord to be, and to give some language for who therefore I know myself to be as one who bears the image of that Lord and is a disciple of that Lord. So I began to pursue this question, what is the metaphorical language in the Bible for God? And if you just pause and think about it, just ask yourself, what are the main names or images that you use for God, like either in your own personal devotional life or in your church community? Because I think all of us and all of our church communities gravitate toward a few different kind of cupfuls of language for God. Most of it's biblical. I hope that most of it's biblical. So in my church community, Episcopal Church, we use a lot of Father language. That's a very primary way of naming who God is. We use a lot of great physician language, Jesus as the great physician. We use a lot of friend language, Jesus as friend, right, coming from the Gospel of John. So those are all great ways of naming God. There are about 9,000,000,003 other ones in the Bible, though. And in my community, and therefore in my own prayer life, I'm just constantly repairing to this handful, this three or four images. So some other images that are in circulation pretty widely in our moment might be king, a lot of king language, shepherd, Jesus as the good shepherd. So as I began to discover the variety of language in the scriptures for God, one of the things I noticed was that my own attention was drawn to images for God in the Bible that have something to do with our current everyday life. So images like king and shepherd do not do a whole lot for me because I don't really know anything about kings and shepherds. I don't know any kings. I am deeply thankful in our given political moment that the language of the Bible is not presidential candidate, Lord as presidential candidate, Lord as Speaker of the House. But at least, I mean, if God forbid that were the language of the scriptures for God, at least I would have some associations with it, like good, bad, and indifferent. King, I mean, I've really got nothing. I mean, queen, I could even picture Queen Elizabeth, you know. I mean, just nothing comes to mind when I think about a king. Shepherd. Well, I was about to say I don't know any shepherds, but that is actually not true. I do know one shepherd. A couple of years ago, I had been ordained for a few years as a priest in the church. I had just taken a job as the quarter-time vicar of this teeny tiny 30-person Episcopal church in the middle of a very small town in North Carolina. And I was so excited about this job and totally terrified. I had no idea if I could do it. It felt like a big responsibility. It still feels like a big responsibility. About a week and a half after I had accepted that job, I flew to Seattle to give some lectures at a UCC church in Seattle. And a woman picked me up at the airport, and she was from the church, and she was driving me into town, and she was telling me all about the church, and they have three pastors, and Pastor X specializes in adult ed and youth ministry, and Pastor Y is the person who specializes in like social justice ministry in the world kinds of things, and Pastor Z is a shepherd. And I said, you know, if 5 years from now, if someone in my congregation is saying that about me, that I am a shepherd, I will really feel that I have learned to be the priest of that community. And I will feel like I have really done what God is calling me there to do. And this woman said, no, she really is a shepherd. And I said, exactly. I mean, if that's what my congregation is saying about me in 5 years, I will just take that as the utmost compliment. And the woman said, Pastor Catherine lives on an island off the coast of Seattle. She has a farm with sheep. She gets up every morning, tends to her sheep, and I am not making it up, I promise you, hops on her motorcycles to the ferry, takes the ferry with her motorcycle into Seattle and goes to her church job. So I've now met Pastor Catherine, and she is now what I think of when I think of Jesus the Good Shepherd. I think of Pastor Catherine on her motorcycle. So I do know one shepherd, and I now have an association with that image. But with the exception of Pastor Catherine, I just don't know that much about shepherds or kings. We could keep going with the biblical language for God that we really have to actually do some work and study, I think, in our current cultural moment to crack open as imagery. But there are plenty of images in the Bible that still are very much part of our everyday life. So I'm going to segue into one of those images. And then at the second half of this lecture, I'm going to give a little bit more about a few other images, and I'm going to try to step back and talk a little bit about why this whole kind of investigation matters. Like, why does it really matter how we image God? So I'm now going to go into some specific ruminations for now on just one image, and I'll pick that up at 7:30 and go back to the big picture. So, I promise you that there are many images for God in the Bible that still have a great deal of resonance with our everyday life, but I'm going to tell you about what is probably my favorite one, and it is the image of God as clothing. So, let's think about clothing in the scriptures. The first place that we encounter clothing in the scriptures in any significant way is in the third chapter of Genesis, which is to say pretty early, pretty darn early in the scriptures, we get a big moment about clothing. So where are we in Genesis 3? Okay, the cosmos has been created, Adam and Eve have been created, the whole tree situation and serpent situation has occurred, God has pronounced the things that will follow now that Adam and Eve have eaten from the tree, right? I'm getting out of order. Before God pronounces those things, Adam and Eve have discovered their nakedness and they've crafted some fig leaf situations for themselves. Then God pronounces what will come to pass. Women will have pain in childbirth, sweat of the brow, laboring in the fields. Women will desire men, etc. All that gets pronounced. And then Adam and Eve are going to have to leave the garden. We're about to be into exile. And right before that happens, the exile part, we get this brief verse in Genesis 3 where we are told that the Lord makes for Adam and Eve some garments of skin. Now, I have known the Adam and Eve story since I was a small person, a little girl at Congregation Beth Hachapilah. In my childhood, I knew the Adam and Eve story. I have always assumed, until pretty recently, I have just always assumed that that verse, that garment of skin thing, means that at that moment, God gave Adam and Eve this. It gave them their skin. So, turns out that's not the dominant interpretation of the verse. The dominant interpretation of the verse is that God made leather tunics for Adam and Eve. God made leather and fur outfits to replace their pathetic fig leaf outfits. And now I have to think that both of those interpretations are right. I like them both. I love the idea that God clothes Adam and Eve in their skin, their actual skin. That's a kind of way of symbolizing that mortality is coming to dwell at this moment when Adam and Eve are being exiled from the garden. Now, if you had asked me as a child what I thought Adam and Eve looked like before this happened, I'm not sure what I would have said. It is Halloween time. You know, those like coloring worksheets we all did in school of like jangly skeletons. I might have thought they looked like that. Or, you know, sometimes you go to the doctor's office and they have those transparent cutaways of the human body, like the muscle system, the sinews, the bones. I might have thought they looked like that. Anyway, the notion of being clothed with skin, but I also love the notion, the more dominant interpretation, that Adam and Eve were clothed by God with these leather outfits. And I love it because it suggests to us something about God's emotional disposition there in Genesis 3. We often assume that God is enraged at this point in the story, but the story doesn't actually tell us that God is enraged. And it seems to me that if God were really enraged, God might not have made these outfits. That this is a real gift, and that God is maybe saying to Adam and Eve, you do have to go. You absolutely have to go. I absolutely love you. I'm really grief-stricken at your leaving, and I want to do this one final thing for you before you leave. I want to give you these beautiful and warm and sturdy outfits. So, it's very striking to me that we get this image so early in the scriptures, because it's not only an image of God giving a gift to Adam and Eve. Of course, God's already given them the gift of existence. Now God is giving them the gift of clothing. It's also an image of God, right? So far, what do we know about God? God is the creator. That might be one language for God that emerges from the Genesis creation story. God is a gardener. That might emerge from the Genesis story. God creates a garden and takes walks in it and so forth. And then we get this image of God as a tailor, or God as a seamstress, making these outfits for Adam and Eve. So it's a very, I think, compelling and striking image of who God is, the God that just endlessly gives gifts to us, even when we are in the midst of our most intense sin. God is still mercifully giving us gifts and making the gifts for us all the time. So once you notice that clothing plays such a significant role in the Genesis story, then you start noticing clothing all over the place in the Bible. You could do a semester-long Bible study on clothing in the scriptures, and it would, A, people would come to it, B, it would take you the entire semester, and C, it would take you all the way from Genesis to Revelation. You would be able to work through the entire purpose of the Bible following clothing as it functions in various symbolic ways in the scriptures. But I want to, before we break at 5:30, I want to take us to the second place in the scriptures that I think, well, for me, it is the other most significant discussion of clothing. And this is in Galatians 3. This is where Paul says that those of us who have been baptized are clothed in Christ. So if you have been wondering where in the Bible it actually says Jesus is a cardigan sweater, it doesn't. But it does say twice, Paul also uses the same language in Romans, does say twice in the scriptures that we are clothed in Jesus. And it's obviously not much of a leap to ask, what is the stuff you're clothed in? It's your clothes, it's your clothing, right? So we're being invited here to think of Jesus as our clothing. And it's a very powerful image. It was common in the ancient world for writers, Christian, Jewish, Greek, Roman, to talk about being clothed in virtues. And of course we see that in the scriptures too, right? clothe yourself in righteousness, etc. That was very common in the ancient world. Clothe yourself in virtue, clothe yourself in mercy, clothe yourself in righteousness. But according to New Testament scholars, Paul is the only ancient writer to speak of being clothed in another person. Not in a virtue, but in a person. And of course, not just any person, but the Lord, right? So we are clothed in Jesus. And I just want us to begin to ask the question, and we'll get some way into this, and then we'll pick back up with this at 7:30, to begin to ask the question, what on earth might that metaphor mean? And if you take away nothing else from this lecture, you're allowed to forget that I was once a mermaid and so forth. I want you to take away the following. You already know a lot about the Bible and how to interpret it from the archive of your everyday life. You do not need to go read a commentary. I mean, it would be useful and interesting to also read a commentary on Galatians, but you don't need to read a commentary to begin thinking about what Paul is offering us about who God is and who we are in this verse in Galatians, because you already know a whole lot about clothing from the archive of your own daily life. So, what do we know about clothing? Well, I'll tell you a couple things about clothing, about 15 minutes. Clothing shapes us in particular directions. Clothing shapes us in particular ways. So I have a habit, and I can tell you more about why I developed this habit if you want to know, but I have a habit of taking the Bible out into the world to read it in some place that I'm not accustomed to reading the Bible in. So I took my Bible to the tallest building in North Carolina, which is a bank, the Bank of America building in Charlotte, and I read the Tower of Babel story to see if I could get any insight into the Tower of Babel story if I read it when I was actually near a very tall building. I took the story of Sarah getting pregnant when she was 903. I took that text to a retirement community and read it there, and that was illuminating. In that story, Sarah laughs, right? She is told that she's going to have a baby, and she sort of cackles. And people are always wondering, is she doubting God? Why is she laughing? She seems to be cynical. Well, reading it there in the retirement meeting, I thought maybe she's laughing because she's like sort of pissed off. I mean, maybe she's thinking, I don't, what? You know, why would I have a baby at this age? Anyhow, so I'm a big believer that where you read shapes what you might see in the text. So I took my Bible to a department store in downtown Raleigh, North Carolina, and sat there with my Bible amid a bunch of actual clothes, reading the Galatians passage. What might I see about clothing and who God is as clothing if I actually read this around some actual clothes? And conveniently enough, there was a poster in the department store that said, had a woman like walking down a Paris runway, and it said, the height of fashion. And it's got me thinking about the word fashion, which is obviously a noun that means like fancy French clothing. But before it was a noun, it was a verb. That was its primary meaning, right? And as a verb, fashion means to shape or to mold or to give shape to something. So you might fashion clay in the shape of candlesticks, right? So the very reason it became a noun meaning clothing is that people recognize that clothing shapes us in particular directions. So I went home from the department store, I looked in my own closet, and I saw that I have basically three kinds of clothing in my closet. I have fancy suits from Talbots that I bought when I was first starting out as a professor, and I don't wear these suits very often anymore. But when I wear them, I carry myself more formally and like in a more mature way. And my posture is actually improving just thinking about these suits. And they shape me in the direction of like the professor who's in pursuit and is, you know, an adult and et cetera, taken seriously. Then I have in my closet a set of like vintage clothes. I have some dresses from the 1930s, and I have some of those polyester novelty shirts from the 1970s. You know the ones I mean? They like button down and they're brightly colored, insane, and pointy collars. So I have a very specific association with those shirts. I attended once a history conference at the University of South Carolina, and I was there with the brilliant and wonderful historian Bethany Morton, who has written the definitive history on the Christian origins of the Walmart Empire. If you want to know about the Christian origins of the Walmart Empire, I didn't even know until Bethany wrote this book that there were Christian origins. If you want to know about them, Bethany is your historian. So I was at this conference with her, and she is just wonderful. She's brilliant, she's political, she's way more comfortable with actual live human beings than I ever will be, and she's funny, and I left the conference just like half wanting to be her best friend and half wanting to be her. And I reflected that every time I've ever been with Bethany Morton, she has like a uniform. She wears blue jeans or corduroys, and then one of these polyester novelty shirts from the 1970s. And so I went back to Durham and I bought 9 of them from a thrift store by the university. And when I put those shirts on, I'm fashioning myself to be a little more Bethany-like. So I'm actually not political, brilliant, or cool, but when I put those shirts on, I'm trying to shape myself in the direction of Bethany-hood. Then there are the clothes that I actually wear in my closet most of the time, and I'm wearing an example of said clothes right now. I have a row of also about 9 shapeless black dresses. This is what I'm wearing 90% of the time. And these shapeless black dresses shape me in a direction that's really much closer to who I actually am than the fancy suits or the cool vintage clothes. So they kind of shape me in the direction of the absent-minded professor who lives more in her head than in her body. And you know, I'm always wearing them with a black cardigan, and sometimes the cardigan is accidentally on inside out. And on a really bold day, I might wear a rust-colored cardigan. And so I just get up in the morning and I don't think about what I look like, and I just grab my black dress and grab my cardigan and throw them on and hop on my tricycle and go tricycling off to my office at Duke. And occasionally there I learn, well, really only once, a very brave student came up to me recently to politely inform me that not only the cardigan, but also the dress, they were both on inside out. So the absent-minded professor in her shapeless black garb. So that's pretty much who I actually am, but sometimes I get kind of sick of being that person who wants to be that person all the time, not I. And when I get sick of being her, I can put on a different kind of garb, a different kind of clothing, and shape myself in another direction, because clothing shapes who we are. And that's, those of us who like it, that's why we like it. Because to change your outfit, to change your look, is not just to change your look, it's actually to play with being a whole different kind of person. So that's one thing that you already know from your own life clothing does. And so you already know from your own life something powerful about what Paul is saying in that passage in Galatians. That Jesus wants to fashion us in a Jesus-like image. That's part of what the clothing language is saying. That's part of what goes on when we imagine God as clothing. That's probably not what goes on when we talk about God as shepherd, right? That's the shepherd image is not about fashioning us to be shepherd-like, exactly. That's not the shepherd's relationship with sheep. But it is clothing's relationship with the wearer of the clothing. So I'm going to briefly mention 2 other things that clothing does, and then we will pause and resume at 7:30. So clothing fashions us to be more exactly like Jesus. A second thing that clothing does is it communicates something about who you are, and it does so without words. And sometimes it communicates quite deep emotional things. So for example, Until the early 20th century, it was pretty common that if someone experienced a death in their family, the person, particularly women, but to a limited extent also men, would wear mourning clothing for 6 months. And that mourning clothing both fashioned them, it both helped them actually be a mourner, but it also communicated to everyone who saw them that they were in mourning. So that's something that clothing does. It communicates something about our deep commitments without ever requiring speech. So that's another layer of meaning that you already know from your own life with clothes that is bound up in the image of God as clothing. And then a third meaning of clothing is that clothing can sometimes help create or help support community. So this is why I teach at Duke University. This is why on game day at Duke University, all of the students come wearing their Duke t-shirts, right? Because the clothing helps constitute the students as a group exactly of Duke students. It's why my sister sometimes annoyingly dresses herself and her daughter in matching mother-daughter outfits. My sister is using the clothing to help underpin, to help support a certain kind of community. Now, that's not always a good thing. Sometimes it's a good thing to support a community, but clothing, as you probably also know from your own life, clothing also can draw barriers between people. It can signal something about your socioeconomic location and draw a barrier between you and other people. In my own life, the most powerful example of that comes every week when I enter a classroom at the women's prison in Raleigh. I teach once a week at the women's prison, and half of our students in these classes are incarcerated women, and the other half are students who come from Duke to be co-students alongside these incarcerated women. And as a teacher in that space, I do all kinds of things to try to equalize the two groups of students. But there's one thing I cannot do anything about, and it is that I and the other people from Duke are wearing whatever happy outfit we thought best, you know, expressed ourselves that morning. And all of the incarcerated women are wearing these sort of ugly seafoam green uniforms. And there is nothing to be done about the strong visual barrier that creates between these two groups of learners and groups of students. So I'll close this hour by returning to Galatians 3 to just call your attention to the verse that sits right next to our clothing verse. Right next to our clothing verse is perhaps a more famous verse from Galatians. And it is that famous verse where Paul says, in Christ Jesus, there is no, then he lists these three is no's, right? There is no Jew, Greek, there is no slave or free, there is no male and female. Now, this final point I'm going to make, you should take with a grain of salt, because I have not found a single biblical scholar to back me up on it, but I think that I have to be right, even so. It strikes me when I read those verses next to each other, in Christ Jesus, you're clothed in Jesus. Through baptism, you've been clothed in Jesus. And in Jesus, there is no Jew, Greek, slave, free, male, female. It's striking to me that those three kinds of identities that get temporarily erased or evacuated or made insignificant or something that get is no'd in Jesus, all of them are things that are created in part through clothing. So obviously, male identity and female identity gets created partially through clothing. In virtually every society with slaves, there are laws saying slaves have to wear clothes from like a certain kind of fabric, and free people have access to certain kinds of fabric that slaves don't, and that those are laws that are to create an immediate visual marker of who is enslaved and who is free. And then the Jew-Gentile thing, in many Christian societies throughout the ages, the church has required Jews to dress in certain kinds of clothing or badge themselves in particular ways so that they will be immediately visually identifiable as Jews. So all three of those distinctions get created in part by clothing, and it is very striking to me that Paul is saying Jesus is clothing, he's not that kind of clothing. He is not the kind of clothing that creates those distinctions. Jesus is more like the school uniform that exactly makes certain kinds of differences invisible for a while, so that people might in fact build relationships with people from different socioeconomic classes, different backgrounds, that for a moment all of these differences are suspended by a kind of clothing that is exactly trying to make it possible for us to have more community with one another, not less, not barriers, not binary identities. So I'm going to stop there because it is 5:30. I think what I'm going to do is not take formal questions right now. I will take some after the 7:30 lecture, but I'm very, very happy just, is this okay? I'm very happy to just linger, and if there are questions that people want to ask in little groups or one-on-one right now, I'm happy to field them. For those of you who can come back, we will pick up at 7:30 to say a little bit more about clothing and to explore another few metaphors from the Bible for who God is, and then maybe, hopefully, we'll have time to make some big picture summings up of why it even matters what kind of language you use for God. So thank you very much for coming. And I hope